fundraising for early stage technology businesses, currently in a fairly traditional sense, but at scale. So, so we look to build communities between investors and investee businesses and make that whole process of funding more efficient. But we've got a few angles on that to explore a little bit further today. Sasha.
I am Waves Platform CEO, and we are like a cryptocurrency blockchain platform that did our own ICO and was pretty successful. We raised close to $18 million, so we were second to Ethereum only. So, and we are focusing on like real world business application of blockchains, and ICOs, this scheme to raise funds directly from the users, is very important, I think. This is the thing that cryptocurrency community is bringing to the world, actually. This is the real value that we're all bringing. This is a new way to raise funds, to manage your business, and I think it's very important and we should make it work in a way. So we should try to make it legitimate and compliant, and it should be working in the future. Thank you.
Hello? Hi, my name is Jeremy Miller. I'm Chief of Staff at Consensus. We are a large blockchain company based in New York with 150 people. We have done a number of token launches, including Singularity, DTV, and have several that are planned. We recently published a paper with Coinbase on the ins and outs and do's and don'ts of ICOs. The tilde version is build software, not tokens. And, you know, we are generally, although obviously our founder effectively ran the Ethereum Ether token launch, and we've done our fair share of token launches, we have a fair amount of skepticism for the viability of most of them.
Let's see if this is working, yeah. Hello, my name is Christoph Herring, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of BitShares Munich. We just closed our pre-ICO a couple of months ago. We raised over 1,000 Bitcoins. And we are focusing on providing the infrastructure for accepting digital currencies for businesses. So if you are a store, a restaurant, a vending machine, whatever you are, we make it possible that you can accept Bitcoins and other currencies all at once for zero cost. Besides that, we are also looking into mobile wallets and other applications. And our goal, basically, with our products is to unite all the different platforms, all the different blockchains that are on the market, to give them the right tools so that you can use even other little currencies or little platforms, little communities like Dogecoin, Litecoin, to use them in a store and to use them as a currency to pay, and we make that possible. And that's also something that we are planning with our next ICO for this summer, to provide basically everybody the right tools so that they can use their favorite currencies in the stores.
Hi. So today we have been hearing about blockchain's application in real estate, the different ventures like land titles registrations, land titles transfer. Well, let's imagine a world in which there's a stock market for property and you can trade it. You can do active day trading on the property. Well, we at StateChain are creating world's first global commercial and residential real estate trading platform. My name is Abhimanyu Dayal. So while studying at my MSc real estate investment in my business school, I came across an idea that we can add so much liquidity into the real estate market just by registering the real estate on the blockchain, creating an ICO, and then people all over the world can just basically participate in this real estate ICO, and we can create a global market for real estate using ICO. So I'm a person who's extremely excited about ICO. I think it's an amazing platform. There's so many people, like, just imagine the next Einstein can be somewhere in Africa and he can use the ICO to fund his venture or his startup, and it can be an amazing platform to share his idea with the rest of the world. And if the world thinks it's feasible, they can fund him. So that's how powerful ICO is.
Guys, thank you very much, and thank you very much for that massive note of enthusiasm, Abhimanyu. We will have, I think, a spot of skepticism introduced into this panel as well as we go along the way. But let's just take one little step back, and I'm going to ask Christoph just to give us a little bit of an overview about what is an ICO and what are the use cases from your perspective.
Well, what we hear this morning already, ICO basically stands for an initial coin offering. So it's a little bit similar to an IPO, but it has different legal characteristics. And what it does, it allows entrepreneurs that have a good idea, that have a good plan, to get funding for their idea, and they are selling out tokens in terms of a reward. It can be a stake, it can be a share of the company, it can be also part like of a donation receipt. And you have a lot of different ways as entrepreneur to structure your ICO and to reward the people. But actually what it really is, and I think I share your idea here as well, it is something, it's a tool that you can give to your fans, to part of your community. You can unite people all around you that are supporting your idea, that are following you, and to make them part of something big. And that is something very special that ICOs enable everybody, because you can do that worldwide. You're not limited to one nation. You can do that worldwide. You can attract people from all over the world.
So the regulators don't believe that.
Hello? Hello? So the regulators don't believe that, right? I mean, if you go and do something that fails the Howey test and market in the US, the SEC will come after you, right? I mean, so I think it's really important up front to separate out the concept of crowdfunding, right, which is a mega trend that's going on, versus what the blockchain brings to this, right? So crowdfunding has been gaining momentum for some period of time, you know, on AngelList and the Crowdcube and these various other platforms, and blockchain provides some value to it as well, because now you can do effectively some form of token issuances. The risk we see in token issuances fundamentally is, are they a security or not? And if you develop a token that is a security, and a lot of the tokens look like a security, you are subject to securities laws. And there's nothing the blockchain does about that, right? If you sell something that's a security and you have not registered it correctly, you are breaking securities laws. So this idea that it's this radical globalization of the economy just is a falsehood, right? Yes, there are some useful things in the technology that do expand the potential markets, but there are laws in place already around how you can raise money for your business. And if you do it wrong, you're going to go to jail.
On that note, we're going to just step back a second. We're going to ask Sasha to come in, because a key point of this is actually, you're absolutely right here, and nobody's going to argue with that, I think, on this panel. But there are some nuances around it. And I think one of the key things here, which carries on from what Christoph was saying, and maybe I can ask Sasha about this, is who are actually the investors here? Who are the people who are the buyers of tokens in ICO? And in your experience from your offering, who are these people?
Some cross between like users who are trying to support the platform and users who want to just make money. So of course, there is some like speculative interest. Imagine Kickstarter with tokens, and you have a prototype and you want to launch the manufacturing. You go to your user base and say, oh, hey, okay guys, I have a prototype and I need money for expanding. So just I want to raise some money and I want to launch the manufacturing in China. And I sell those tokens to you and you can swap them back to the actual product when it's ready. So is it a security?
That may be, right? Because the problem with that, the problem with that structure is it's exchangeable back for something else. And that's one of the holes you can fall into in designing a token. Because if it starts to look like a swap, then it falls under a different class of regulation.
But it's not equity. It's not bond.
It could still be a swap. A gym membership.
But it's a voucher.
A gym membership, if it's structured incorrectly, is a security, right? There are examples of gyms getting sued for violating securities laws because they designed their gym memberships incorrectly. So if one form of asset is exchangeable for another form of asset, you run into where you need to take legal advice is, have I created a swap? And if I've created a swap, I've created a security.
But for example, Groupon model, you sell those vouchers to users, and is it security or not?
No, but they're just selling a discount.
But it's the same thing actually. But it's tradable discount. It just blockchain gives a new new degree of freedom. You can trade it.
But it might or it might not. I think it might give. It might be providing a discount. It might be providing access to a service. Or it might. And I think you just said it a second ago. It might actually be offering something which is expected to have an increase in value.
So in the U.S., the key thing is the Howey test, right? Which is a three-part test, actually a four-part test, but you can simplify it to three parts, which says, is it a common enterprise? Is it with the expectation of profit, and are you putting in money? And if you do those three things, it's a security, right? Now, then you run into more complicated tests around swaps, right? And there are various other things. So which is why, you know, our philosophy on this tends to be focus on the software first. You know, the real thing you want to do when you're doing a token launch is make sure that you can define the utility of the token in the system. So what Ethereum was very, very careful to define the role of Ether to ensure that the system was deterministic, right? So Ether has a very clear and well-defined role in the mechanics of how Ethereum as a system works. So, you know, when you start to look at these things, and I look at a lot of them, you look at what do you get caught up in the Howey test or the equivalent in Europe, and then you look at what's the utility of the token relative to the platform.
I think that's right, and one way or another, something like £200 million worth of ICO was completed in 2016. Okay, one way or another, there were scores of transactions completed during 2016. So one way or another, there is a thing going on here, which is either going to get regulated out of existence, or is going to find
a
way through.
Well, it's already regulated. It's already regulated.
Well, the existence of the ICO, so the point at which the regulator steps into some of these transactions and points out that is actually regulated activity. And you're absolutely right. I mean, there's no specific doubt around regulation. But what I just want to move the dialogue along a little bit.
That yes, there are risks that you can fall in this legal hole that you are structuring an ICO in a way that you're getting sued at the end because you raised money that you shouldn't do or you didn't pay the taxes for raising the money and so on. I think what is way more important, and I think that's what we see more in the industry now, is that we are seeing services. Companies are coming in that are providing ICO services for entrepreneurs who have that idea, but they know nothing about the legal structure, and they also don't really have the money yet to consult a lawyer. And I think we see now new platforms where you can easily get that consultancy, and they are also structuring the right framework. What can you do? You have an idea, and you want to raise money through an ICO. Okay. How do you do that? What can you do? For how much money can you actually raise? And I think that's what we're going to see. And that is necessary for all of us because right now it's a Wild West. Everybody's just trying around and see what flies, but we don't really know yet.
And there are platforms in the traditional world like Vested that do exactly that, which is a market which is paid for in equity for services that are provided. But Abhimanyu, I want to bring you in for a second here and just ask in terms of this, the burgeoning demand that you were talking about here and the idea that actually... Where do you see the use cases? Where do you see the opportunities within Jeremy's concerns about what is regulated and what is not regulated? Because that's very clear.
Sure. First of all, we have to understand what the technology is. Before we go out there and start regulating blockchain or ICO, we first have to understand it. And to be honest, we don't understand it. If you look at the example of Sweden, Sweden is regulating Bitcoin as an art because according to their definition, money is issued by the government. So blockchain is... Bitcoin is not issued by the government. So what it is? Oh, it's like a Mona Lisa. And that's a kind of regulation they are forming around it. So we don't understand it. We have to step back, see the technology, see the diffusion of the technology, what it can done, what it can do, what it brings with it in the future. And then we start creating laws around it. It seemed like internet, where internet, if we started regulating the internet and we would be all working on intranet. And who wants to use intranet? Right? So, and that's a difference between...
So our view on this is it's already regulated.
I'm going to ask to move this to a slightly different level. Regulation exists for financial services transactions. That is absolutely clear. So we have this slight debate about what is a financial services transaction and what is not in different jurisdictions. Okay? Plain, clear. Now then. Let us deal with a slightly different aspect of this, Sasha, and I'm going to ask you to come in on this, which is to say, within that framework and within the experience of ICOs to date, there have been good experiences and there have been bad experiences. So how does the vouchering and cryptocurrency world deal, in this particular instance, with the sorts of issues that have come up in the past around governance, around quality of information, around due diligence, and around redress at the point when things go wrong?
I, I think in that respect, cryptocurrency world imitates like the real world. So some kind of rating agencies are starting to appear now. People are trying to like vet the projects collectively, and some kind of rating agencies and like reputation systems. I think the whole machinery will be there sooner or later, and it will be like complementary to the real world rating agencies. So it's all like possible. And what I want to add here is, you know, we promote some other perspective on ICOs. So we want people to issue custom application tokens, so-called. Yeah, so you can use them in your product, and they can have value. You know, you can't prohibit them from having value. You know, it is used, for example, you issue an internal currency in your social network, and you make a pledge that you will provide network-wide advertisement for anybody who wants to pay you 100 coins. And at the beginning of the year, you had 1,000 users in your social network. At the end of the year, you have 1 million users, but you still provide the same amount of advertisement. I mean, the amount of advertisement is bigger, actually. But you make a pledge to make the network-wide advertisement. So the value of the token grows through this, because you provide more service, you provide more value. Is it a security? I don't think so. It's like, no, it's a product.
So that probably, so the key there is the utility factor, right? And it's not an investment in a collective enterprise from a US perspective. So that type of stuff you can get away with. Where it starts to become difficult is if you're to make the, is what you can exchange that token for, right? So that would probably be okay. Like, this is the thing that we really stress. If you're gonna do a token launch, you've got two options. It is okay to issue a token that's a security, right? You just need to comply with the security laws that apply to it. Or you need to make sure it really is integrated into the software platform.
Yeah, you can't sell equity in our company, it's obvious. But you can do other things, I think, and that are compatible with current security laws, I think.
Yeah.
Can you sell a token that is convertible immediately into a currency?
So if it's one token that's convertible into another, there's a risk you'll get caught up under swaps
Correct.
Law.
Any other comments from Christoph or from Abhimanyu on this question of governance or quality and how those things are dealt with in this world?
I think most of the governance and the quality would come from the community itself. So people should, if people are investing, then they should be able to know what they are investing in. So that on behalf of the company who are issuing the token, should have a full public disclosure of their business plan and everything, what they're raising the money from, for, and the people who are investing, it's their duty to do their due diligence and to know what they are getting into. Because, and I also believe some of the tokens can be structured in a way they are private property, so it's more like a gold. If you walk down the road and you give a gold coin to someone, then it becomes his private property, and they are loads of these tokens which are structured in this way.
So you want to be a bit careful with what you put out in terms of a business plan, because the issue is how directed is your offering. So if you put out something that might be, so this is where you really need to take good legal advice. If you're perceived as broadly marketing a security, you get in even more trouble, right? So yes, your points around you should have a business plan, you should have lots of disclosure, that's true, but the caution there is who can access it. Right? So, and under what conditions? So you need the flip side of there is good practice around what you should do. The flip side of that is, well, who has access to it under what conditions, right? So in Europe, for example, you want to do it, this isn't advice, but what you want to look at is the offering directed or not? And if it is directed, have you conformed with the European prospectus requirements? If what you're doing starts to look like it's going to be a security. Or have you sufficient, the other option is, have you sufficient documentation that what you're selling is a piece of code?
So Christoph, is it fair to say then that we've got two elements here? We've either got these transactions, as Jeremy's been saying, which are effectively securities transactions. You're selling something that is a financial instrument. Or with Kickstarter.
Well, even in Kickstarter, you have legal laws you have to follow. So this is in this way the same game. But I think what is more important, because legally you can solve these kind of issues. You can talk to lawyers. You can find the right partners who can cover that. I think from an entrepreneur perspective, if you want to do an ICO, you have to consider a lot of other things as well. And that is about your marketing. How do you approach people? How do you approach potential investors that want to invest into your idea, into your project? And here you also have to follow, of course, a lot of rules, because right now it's a Wild West. And experience and the observation of many, many ICOs just showed that it's not just you're publishing a white paper and you get a million. This is the past. A lot of people got burned already, and this is then where the regulator comes in, because he says, like, okay, well, we want to protect investors, and if the investor lose all their money, then we have a problem. So what we have to see is now we have to get a community consensus where we say we need to be openly communicating what is the goal with that ICO, how do we use the money, who has control over the money, what are we going, how are we going to use the money in the future, how do we store it? So there's a lot of different questions that has to be answered by the entrepreneurs, by the companies who are doing the ICO. And here we still have not enough standardization. So I think that really has to come, because then also for us as like individuals, we want to invest, it makes it easier to decide, okay, this is a good idea, this is a bad product. Because what we see today, we have a lot of ICOs that happened, they raised millions, but they are just developers. They lack the business skills. They don't know how to build up a team, they don't know how to do a good marketing campaign. They're sitting on million right now, but they cannot spend it because they don't know how to build a business. And that is a big problem, because for these kind of ICOs, the money is lost. It's very hard to get it back.
Sure. And so is this, and you've got something you want to say as well, but I've got a question to add to it, or even two questions. Is this then a sort of a social enterprise kind of model? Is it about almost somewhere between a grant and social enterprise investing that is behind the a significant portion of the ICOs that have happened to date?
I believe, yes, it's a social enterprise kind of thing. What I also believe is that businesses don't need money. Businesses need advice. There's a reason why 95 to 96% of the Kickstarter fail, including Pebble, which just recently got taken over for a fraction of its value. So business need advice. So I think it is very important to structure your ICO really well. ICO should happen on Series A or Series B. Seed capital should come from angel investor who has a very sound idea and a good knowledge about the market, what can be the possibility of the product or how to market it. He's absolutely right saying that it's mostly, previously it was all developers just writing 30 pages and trying to raise like $7-8 million in ICO and then just being burnt out on the journey. And they were observed from a social entrepreneurship kind of perspective, or people who were involved in these ICOs, they knew it was a kind of a donation, they might make the money in the long term, but it was a seed investment, and all seed investments are risky. Even the VC firms who are extremely, extremely experienced, they have a probability of 0.9% failure. So they make returns on 0.1% probability. And if we look at that perspective, yes, it is extremely risky. And when people are participating in the ICO, when they are funding these startups, they have to take these things into consideration. And it is us as an investor's responsibility to take these things into consideration. If we are going towards the social entrepreneurship or funding a good social idea, then we should forget about the monetary outcome of the project.
I think a couple of points on that. I think, first of all, the way in which you just described this, talking about Series A, Series B, talking about investments and so forth, you might just have failed the regulation test. And so maybe the social side...
Well, you'd probably start failing the marketing, right? Like, the issue there is it would start to look like a broad-based marketing of a security, whether the underlying thing was a security or not. By the way, we don't think that... We have nothing wrong with marketing securities, right? The current ICO I'm working on will be a registered security. In fact, it'll be an unregistered security, but it will be a security. And we are working through the legal requirements to ensure that it complies with the various security regulations that apply to it. So there's nothing wrong with doing an ICO that's a security. You just better have a lawyer that understands the securities laws.
Luis, do we have the time to do a couple of Q&As? We do? Okay. Right here in the front row.
Okay, so I can just shout it out. I have a question. Let's say I minted my own token, and I don't want to like get in trouble, and then someone just lists it on the exchange. Is it also I get caught in this one situation?
You'd want to take legal advice way before then. So the first thing.
I mean, I can just open my computer and just mint it.
Sure. So, but remember, the regulators have, depending on the jurisdiction, 5 to 7 years to go and look back, right? So the idea that there's been £200 million of ICOs and the regulators don't care is not necessarily true. Every single one of those people could face a regulatory investigation for the next 5 years.
Well, it's too late for me now.
No. So the answer is so we have a white paper published with Coinbase, which gives some guidelines on, you know, how to make sure it's a software token, what the key sort of securities law tests are that you can read. It's 27 pages long. It includes a legal opinion at the end of it. But the answer is up front, before you do anything, I mean, there are many things that people talked about the business plan, what have you. You need to design the token. And if you want to avoid it being a security, you need to design it so that it's a component of the software platform, like you were talking about.
Excuse me, can I just summarize it? Probably doesn't have to be equity. You can't promise dividends. And it doesn't have to be like public offering. Yes, then it's compliant. Or could you summarize
Not necessarily. Not necessarily. You know, private securities have laws following them too, right? In the U.S., the test is collective enterprise with the intention of profit, basically. And did you invest in it? And if you've done that, then you have a security. In Europe, in Europe, the rules are somewhat similar. So the key is what you were saying at the beginning, which is what is the software utility of the token independent of its financial value? And that's where you need to be careful.
Another question. Right there at the back.
What is the advantage of an ICO, whether it's a security or not? Because for me, I'm still a bit confused if it is just avoiding the regulation, or there is something more?
Can I reply to this? Doing an ICO, you're not only raising funds, you gain users, and you get testers, you get promoters. You know, there is synergy between different things. And it's not only money, it's not about money. It's about community, mostly. So it's a great thing. It's worth developing, I think, because it's a new way for businesses to operate.
It also helps, if you think about it, also help you to evaluate your business idea. So if you are running an ICO, you do all the legal groundwork, you make it all correct. At the end, you see how much value actually your idea has. Are there enough people who think your idea is good and are interested to chip in money? If there are not enough money is coming together, then you already have a signal that the idea is maybe not good enough.
Which is why in our internal guidelines for token issuance is written by our general counsel, the first line is build software, not tokens, right? Focus on what your software is going to do and where the value is in the software platform, exactly to your point.
Time for one more. Is there one more? In the middle.
This is an internet thing, so presumably I can put my servers for this anywhere. So should I put them somewhere offshore and avoid all this hassle?
Well, you won't if you sell a security in the UK. The FCA can come after you. Whether the server sits in Mauritius or Singapore or Taiwan doesn't matter. If you sell a security in the UK, you are conducting a regulated activity in the UK.
But in that case, how do I stop people? You know, if it's good for Europe but it's not good for the States, how would I stop people?
So we look at we do IP blocked lists, we do KYC. When we look at our token launches, we decide, is there a risk that it's a security or not? If it's not a security, we have a more liberal policy. But if it's a security, we look at it as if we're selling shares. And we make sure we comply with the rules on how you sell shares.
So basically, you're talking about a platform where investors can go to, and then they can see a list of different projects they could invest. And then they have to register, they have to comply to all regulations, and then they can start investing. Yeah?
So it's about accredited investors, probably. Or?
Yeah, the accreditation of the investor, where they're based, all the other stuff. But the first thing is what you're doing a security, or can it be viewed as a component of a software system? And the first thing you want to do is try and make sure it's a component of a software system, because that's how you avoid, you know, the regulation.
But doesn't mean you're actually totally out of any legal problems. If you say, like, this token that I created needs to be used like fuel in my software, in my platform that I built, then I'm totally out.
Well,
or?
Well, I mean,
gentlemen, we're going to need to wrap up here to move on to the next discussion. Very, very brief summary here. I guess what we're talking about here is an extraordinarily vibrant and significantly increasing and growing sector where there's an obviously massive gotcha in terms of this regulation aspect, which has to be kept at the very forefront of everybody's minds. But for very early stage, highly technical innovation, what a fantastic tool, and long may it continue. Thank you very much to the panel, and thank you to the audience.
So, I